And we go to the last talk of the session, and that is the Dr. J.G. Nagy Young Scientist Award. And Dr. Nagy was a brilliant scientist, and he initiated many researches at the National Geophysical Research Institute, basically in theoretical geophysics. Very well respected individual. Unfortunately, we lost him a few years ago. And it is very thoughtful of his family to institute this award in his name. And we have a very good speaker for this, Dr. Shubhra Sharma. Are you there?
Yes, Professor Gupta. Thank you so much.
And Shubhra, you have the honor to have the last word in this session.
Thank you so much, Professor Gupta. So I hope my screen is visible. So good afternoon to everyone. And I'm very grateful for the honor and the recognition for my work on quaternary glaciation of Himalaya that NGRI and IGU has given to me. And I will be discussing the same work. So the title of my talk is Late Quaternary Glacier Fluctuations in the Himalaya, Evolving Perspectives. So before I summarize my own work, very quickly, I will be discussing how the quaternary glaciation science has progressed through time. So these three gentlemen helped in propagating the science of quaternary glaciation. Luis Agassé, who was a very young, enthusiastic fish paleontologist, mapped extensively the evidence of continental glaciation across the European mountains. And together with William Buckland, he was able to convince Charles Lyell, a very great geologist, that indeed in the past, glaciers had advanced in multiple phases. The pivotal evidence were these rocks. So the first two gravels that you're seeing, they are grooves or striations etched on their surface, which are the resultant of glacial erosion. And the second photograph that you are seeing is an erratic, that is a huge boulder of a different lithology than the underlying bedrock surface over which it is lying at a high altitude. Both these evidence could not be explained by the biblical flood theory of that time, and this helped to push this theory forward. And with time, classical four-fold models of glaciation started coming up. For example, for the Alpine glacier systems, four glacial stages were proposed, like Wurm, Riss, Mindel, and Gunz. And similarly, for the North American glaciers, also similar kind of model was proposed. However, this soon became obsolete as we had oxygen isotope data from the marine cores. So here I'm just, for example, I'm showing oxygen delta O18 data from Atlantic core and Pacific core, where you can see the pits and the peaks representing the glacial and the interglacial period. So interglacial periods here are represented by these peaks and are denoted by more negative delta O18 values. Clearly, we know that there were more than four cycles of glacials and intervening interglacials. Then in for the context of Himalaya in 1970s and 80s, extensive mapping started taking place for the quaternary glaciation. And with the first chronometric data that started coming in the 1990s, also the correlation with the paleoclimate and inferences about the response of the glaciers started coming up. So very briefly, I wanted to show what kind of geomorphic archives or landforms are used in these studies. For example, here you can see an extensive laterofrontal moraine in the Ladakh Himalaya, which are deposited as a glacier advances. Pro-relict flow glacial lakes, which are formed at the snout of a glacier. And as it just begins receding, such kind of lakes begin to form. Drumlins, which are depositional landforms formed by the modification of the subglacial till by meltwater streams, and outwash terraces, which are very diagnostic expression of major glacial retreats in any mountain valleys. So we extensively map these landforms, build the event stratigraphy, including the cross-cutting relationships, also infer the depositional environment using basic sedimentology, and try to establish a relative chronology using attributes like degree of weathering, altitude, pedogenesis, and sometimes lignometry also in the field. Another major tie point in these studies is that of the absolute chronology. Now, you may already know that in quaternary science, we are trying to understand an event from the discrete and fragmented records of the landforms. And for that, this absolute chronology serves as an important tie point for comparison with the more continuous and higher resolution climate records like those from the speleothems or ice cores and marine cores. So the most extensively used technique for the Himalayan glaciation is terrestrial cosmogenic nuclei dating technique. And in this cartoon, I have tried to show the basic principle of this technique. So for example, in the first cartoon, you see a glacier has expanded. It has deposited the moraine, covered the bedrock. In the second cartoon, you see that this glacier has gone back. And during this recession, it has exposed the fresh surface of the bedrock. This the silica oxide in the freshly exposed bedrock surface interacts with the atmospheric cosmic ray flux to produce various nucleides. The most commonly used is beryllium-10 for dating. And to get the age, we measure the total concentration of beryllium-10 and divide it by the rate of production. Most commonly used sampling surfaces in this technique are the glacially eroded bedrock surfaces that you can see in the first picture, and also the moraine boulders that you can see in the second picture. Second extensively used technique is the luminescence dating technique, which gives us the deposition age of the landforms like moraines, lake deposits, or outwash gravel terraces. Here in the second cartoon, again, I've tried to summarize its basic premise, which is that the luminescence signal in minerals like feldspar and quartz, it gets bleached or reset to zero as soon as these minerals are exposed to light. And once they are buried during a depositional environment away from the light, again, the luminescence signal starts getting accumulated, which is in response to the natural radiation it is receiving from the surrounding sediments. And we sample sand lenses, which we can infer that has been deposited in the supraglacial environment. So for an example, I have shown a supraglacial lake over a glacier where you can find such sand lenses and ensure that satisfies the basic premise of this technique. And this section shows one such sand lens in the geological section embedded within the moraine deposit. So now coming back to the Himalaya, we all know that it is the northwestern, western, and the central sector is affected by two major climate systems, that is the Indian summer monsoon and the middle latitude westerlies, and both have precipitation gradients associated with them. So for example, here I have shown an elevation profile drawn from Indo-Gangetic plain till Karakoram and schematically overlaid the contribution from these two weather systems. So after the major orographic barrier of higher Himalayan range, we see the contribution from the Indian summer monsoon systematically decreases at the expense of mid-latitude westerlies. And we wanted to understand and how the glacier response is along this precipitation gradient. And therefore, we selected a few valleys right across from Karakoram, Ladakh, Jhanskar, and Upper Ganga Valley. So very quickly, I will be going through some of the key photographs and evidence from these valleys before I summarize the major inferences. So coming to the Karakoram Himalaya, where modern precipitation is dominated by mid-latitude westerlies. This is the Landsat imagery where you can see Siachen Glacier. From here, the river Nubra emanates, and we traversed along this valley documenting various landforms. So for example, this is a Google Earth imagery that shows two major advances in a form of extensive lateral moraines. We named these as Tirath 2 and Tirath 1. This is the field photograph of the same location. Tirath 2 was dated between about 60 to 40 kilo years using luminescence dating technique, and it corresponds to the cooler phase of marine isotope stage 4. And the younger advancement, Tirath 1, is dated between about 30 to 18 kilo year, and it corresponds to another major cooling event, that is the marine isotope stage 2 or MIS-2. It also includes the time span of last glacial maxima, which is constrained between about 24 to 18 kilo years. And this becomes important because the northern latitude ice sheets have responded to both these cooling events and expanded catastrophically in the past. And earlier studies, on the other hand, suggested that Himalayan glacier response was asynchronous with the ice sheets, and we observed no advance during these cooling phases. On the contrary, we found the evidence to support the synchronous advancement. Okay. Besides that, we also documented younger advances corresponding to mid-Holocene cooling event and the Little Ice Age. So moving further, little southeast, we occupied a small tributary valley called the Puche Glacier Valley, just above the town of Leh in the Ladakh Ranges. And again, could decipher three major glacial advances. The first picture here shows Puche Glacial 1 advance and Puche Glacial 2 advance. And this is the close-up of this, close-up shot of this terminal moraine here. This PGA-1 was dated between 30 to about 22 kilos. Again, it corresponds with the MIS-2 and the last glacial maxima event. Whereas the younger PGA-2 advance, we suggested that it responded to the cooling of older and younger dryas, suggested to be generated by the fresh meltwater pulses. Okay, coming to the further southeast in the Jhanskar Ranges, we occupied glacial valleys in southern and eastern Jhanskar. This area is very critical to understand the response of the glaciers particularly to the Indian summer monsoon, because most of the catchment of the glaciers, they are located on the leeward side of the higher Himalayan range, which is the major orographic barrier. Now, studies have suggested that during the intensified phases of monsoon is able to cross over this orographic barrier and reach otherwise drier regions. So if as suggested by earlier studies, Indian summer monsoons are to trigger a glacial advance, any intensification of monsoon should be manifested in these glaciers. But we did not find so. Instead, again, we documented the advances which correspond to these cooling phases of MIS-4, Elgium, late glacial, and mid-Holocene. So just for the example, I wanted to show, the first picture is from Badam Valley in Jhanskar Ranges, where you can see a laterofrontal moraine. And this event is dated between about 23 to 19 kilo years. And the younger event, which is shown in the second photograph, just terminates at the exit of the tributary valleys. It has been dated to late glacial cooling period event. Similar events were documented for this Drangdrung Glacier. I'm not showing the pictures in the interest of time here. Another interesting observation that we made in Jhanskar Valley was the spectacular series of recessional moraines were preserved in the valleys. As you can see, these are marked by these yellow arrows here. These recessional moraines represent the halting of glacier recession in overall when there was a phase of retreat going on. And this we suggest that was in response to the sentinel scale cooling event. Again, suggesting that glaciers in Himalaya, they are sensitive to even the small scale climate perturbations. Now, so far I have kind of presented evidence from northwestern and western Himalayan sector, where we found glacier advances, extensive ones, to corresponding to MIS-4, MIS-2, which are the cold phases dominated by the strengthened westerlies. Now, we wanted to see if the westerlies were strengthened and they follow a east-to-west gradient, how far they could influence or how far they could trigger the glacial advance. So we occupied Upper Ganga catchment in this otherwise monsoon-dominated central Himalaya and see if we could get this kind of signature here also. So here I'm showing Google imagery of Paschimi Kamet tributary valley. And again, we could document three glacial advances here, which are represented by PK1, 2 and 3. The Paschimi Kamet 1 glacial advancement is the oldest one, and we find the moraine corresponding to this much downstream in the Trunk Valley that you can see in this field photograph. And this event is again dated to the last glacial maxima, implying that strengthened westerlies could trigger an advancement in this region also, and monsoon perhaps did not trigger an advancement. Another interesting observation was that the outwash gravel terraces, which were either abutting the moraines or they were present as extensive surfaces in further downstream of the valley, they were dated to the period of early Holocene, which corresponds with the intensification of the monsoon. Now, this became very interesting because if monsoons were to trigger an advance, especially in this region, we should get the moraines corresponding to this event and not the diagnostic feature of the deglaciation event. Okay, so if I quickly summarize all the evidence make major inferences, I'm not showing here the proxy records of climate that we've used for the sake of simplicity. So I'll just quickly jump on to the major conclusions. So firstly, we did not find evidence of glacier advances that were older than MIS-4, that is older than 80 kilo years or so, implying that such landforms in Himalaya have low preservation potential. This is in contrast with some of the earlier suggestions which suggested Himalayan advancement in Ladakh, Himalaya as old as 400 kilo years. As I said previously, the glaciers we found are sensitive to the colder westerlies dominated phases, that is MS4 to particularly the last glacial maxima. And we observed that the response was extensive and it was synchronous with the northern latitude ice sheets, which is again in contrast with the earlier suggestion where the extent of the last glacial maxima was either suggested to be very limited or it was suggested to be altogether absent. And the reason was because they were considering Indian summer monsoon as the primary driver for these glaciations. For the period younger than 20 kilo years, that is the post-LGM, we found that glaciers respond sensitively to the millennial scale cooling periods like that of the late glacial or mid-Holocene, whereas they do respond to the sentinel scale cooling also, but the response is varied. For example, in Ladakh and Nubra Valley, glacier triggered a minor advance to these smaller events, but in Jhanskar, we instead found that it did not trigger an advance, but halted its continuous recession. So that is the variation in glacier response. The period of early Holocene is perhaps the most interesting because we are documenting deglaciation all across these Himalayan sectors in all the valleys, which is in stark contrast to the earlier suggestions. Also, we are noticing a pan mid-Holocene minor advancement in the various valleys, which is also again the period of weak monsoon and millennial scale cooling. So I think the way ahead for these studies would be independent validation of glacial chronology from high resolution climate records of proglacial lakes and ice cores. But these landforms, they have to be genetically associated with the moraines. The reason being that right now we are heavily dependent upon the chronology for our climatic inferences. Which are reasonable, but it would be nice to have a cross validation from these high resolution records. Once, if we have these records, it would also perhaps help us to understand the variable response of the glacier at sentinel scale. There are several hypotheses that are being produced, like it is the aspect of the valley or shape of the valley or the size of the glacier that varies this response, but we are not certain right now. Also, we observed that always the OSL and the exposure ages, they are not in conformation with each other, particularly in sectors of northwestern and western Himalaya, where the exposure ages are grossly overestimated. So we did propose that there are several geological processes which are contributing to this overestimation of the ages, like, for example, contribution of lot of moraine boulders from the smaller glacial tributaries, which have a short distance of transport. But all these hypotheses, they need to be tested rigorously with a greater database. So I think with that, I would like to conclude, thanking my collaborators and also my institutions. Thank you.
Shubhra, that was a brilliant talk. I really compliment you for being very focused, sticking to the time, and making your point very clear. I won't open your talk for any questions because we are already more than half an hour late. I must thank all the three speakers for joining this session and making it a very memorable session. And I must thank the human geophysical people to give me this opportunity to associate myself with these three brilliant talks. Thank you, all of you. Thanks a lot. Back to Abhay Ramachandran.
Thank you, Professor Gupta, for chairing this session wherein three important talks were delivered. Thank you so much. On behalf of the Local Organizing Committee and IGU, we profusely thank you for chairing this session. We request all the delegates to please leave this meeting and then join the concluding session link in 5 minutes. The link is already active, so please join the concluding session link. Thank you so much.